Ermin Stacker, who's working now at Samba Nova, but I guess this work was done while he was at ARM, and he will talk about hardware-aware dynamic inference technology. So you have the stage. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Boris. So hello everyone, and thank you for attending this talk today. So today I'll be talking about conditional computation, or as I'll be interchangeably using, dynamic inference technologies. So this was still an early work research that I'm presenting, but my hope is that by the end of this presentation, you learn four things. First, you become aware of what conditional computation technologies are. Second, why they can be a better alternative to static computation techniques. Third, how you identify conditional computational technologies that optimize for orthogonal modalities, and how do you combine them? And last, how do you make them hardware aware? Okay, so let's dive into it. So we all know this picture, right? Deep learning has led to superhuman performance in tasks like object recognition, but that has also come at a significant cost in terms of model size and latency cost. But a lot of different applications where we want to actually run these a lot of different applications actually run on devices which are much smaller, or in constraint latency constraints which are much shorter. So the way we have generally solved these techniques or problems is to use techniques like pruning, quantization, and low rank decomposition. I'll club together all of these techniques and call them things that are sort of static compression techniques. The reason I use the word static is because they permanently alter the structure of a neural network. Things once pruned cannot be recovered back. Things once quantized cannot be recovered back at the fuller precision at which they were existing. Now, this has helped us get to a really good point in where we are right now. But we are also seeing some limitations with these techniques. Specifically, we have seen in the previous talks, and we have seen results in research that as you keep pushing these techniques to push the limits of compression, accuracy starts falling off. Another interesting thing that has come out in research recently, and this was a paper from Google, is that they explored these static compression techniques, and what they realized is that static compression techniques insert a certain bias in the data set, in the model. Bias in the terms that if your data set has multiple classes, then static compression techniques would favor certain classes more than others. As a result, your compressed neural network would have a higher accuracy on certain classes and lower accuracy on the other classes. So this got us motivated as to ask the question why this is happening and how we can solve them. And this is where we started exploring dynamic inference or conditional execution technologies. So conditional execution technologies are techniques that keep all of the neural network, but activate only part of the neural network depending on the input. So for each different input, the part of the neural network that is executed is slightly different. Because we keep all of the parameters, in theory, we should be able to achieve all of the accuracy that we have in baseline. And because you only execute part of the network, that means you should be able to get faster inference runtime when you run it on a hardware device. And also your active memory footprint of the neural network also decreases. Now I've talked about why conditional execution is interesting. I haven't really talked about what conditional execution is. So let's look at this example, which sort of talks about one specific type of conditional execution technique. Suppose you have an object recognition network that is trained for detecting cats versus dogs. Now this recognition network would have CNN filters which are specialized for cat features and CNN filters which are specialized for dog features. Now, when we pass a dog image through this, output channels which correspond to filters that are specialized to dog features would get activated, and everything else would have a value of zero or a very low value. When we pass a cat image through this network, output channels corresponding to filters associated with cat features would be activated and everything else would be zero. So then the question becomes, why do we even execute the part of the network which are going to have low activation values or zero values altogether? And conditional computation technologies ask such questions and exploit opportunities to create efficient inference networks for such modalities. Depending on the type of opportunity that the conditional execution network executes, there can be multiple different classes of conditional execution networks. But for the purpose of this presentation, I only talk about the top two, that is dynamic channel selection and dynamic precision selection. And I'll talk about the work that we have done in this domain. Dynamic channel selection or dynamic channel pruning is the conditional execution technique that we saw previously with regards to filters. So what happens in this technique from a Your network point of view is that you take the input feature map before every layer, pass it through a very, very, very simple predictor network. The predictor network determines what output channels are important and what output channels are not important, and reads in the weights for only those output channels which are important. Another interesting type of conditional execution technique is dynamic precision selection. In case of dynamic precision selection, you again take your input feature map, but in this case, you pass it through a layer which is at a very, very, very low precision, say 1 bit, and you use that 1 bit layer to determine what parts of the input feature map are important. So in a way, you can think of that, in a way, you can think about it in terms of foreground versus background, that one bit layer or 2 bit layer is trying to determine what objects are important and bring it to the foreground. Once you determine the parts of the input feature map which is important, then you pass the same input feature map but with these important regions marked and pass it through a higher precision network. Now you're executing this network in two phases, but the first phase is at, say, 1 bit or 2 bit precision, and the second phase would be at 4 bit or 8 bit precision. So overall, your execution time is quite fast. Now, this is where the first contribution of this work comes into picture. We identify dynamic execution or dynamic inference or computational execution techniques that are orthogonal to each other. We show why they are orthogonal. We show that after combining them, they do actually, in fact, take out orthogonal pieces of optimization opportunities and show the results with them. So in this case, we are sort of exploiting two different techniques, the dynamic channel pruning technique and dynamic precision technique, and combining them to create a faster network. Now, I won't go into the details of that. I'll point to the paper eventually in the end, which talks about these details, but I'll leave you with this one specific result. Here we have a baseline network, which is at around 92% accuracy, and we are trying to reduce the ops count of this network. We use static pruning, and we see we are not really getting good results out of it. We use dynamic precision selection, and we again see that we are not really getting good results beyond a certain reduction factor. Dynamic channel pruning does slightly better, but again, as we push the limits of back reduction, we are again struggling. And this particular line, which is the pushing the Pareto frontier, is the work that we did, which is combining these conditional computational technologies together, and we are able to get a new Pareto frontier curve where we are really able to push to 5x reduction with minimal loss in baseline accuracy. Now, not all MAC reductions translate into CPU speedup. And that was the second contribution of this work, sort of adding hardware awareness. Now, before we jump into why conditional computation technologies might not be hardware aware, let's look at how CNNs are executed on CPUs. Now, we are all familiar with this picture. Right? To execute CNNs efficiently on a CPU, we go through an imp to call phase that converts all of our CNN kernels, our input feature map, the weights into 2D matrices. We execute gem, and then we create a 2D output feature map, which is then converted into the 3D tensor that we are more used to seeing. And the reason we do that is that in spite of the overhead of imp to call, during execution, because we are using gem kernels, which can be effectively vectorized, you can use cache blocking, register allocation, et cetera, do all these optimizations, you still get a faster inference kernel than doing your vanilla convolution. Now, for these gem kernels to work efficiently, vectorization is an important component. However, dynamic channel pruning breaks vectorization, right? So dynamic channel pruning determines that certain input channels are not important, or output channels are not important, and it doesn't read in the weights corresponding to output those output channels in the cache. Now, in this case, if you determine that these two channels are not important, then these two columns of weights are not written. But that breaks your gem assumption. A compiler would convert this gem call into a gem v call. So the question becomes, how do we improve upon this? And we show in our work that by simply adding a vector awareness, we are able to still train dynamic channel pruning techniques with high accuracy without losing the goodness of these techniques. So, and these are some of the results out of this. We are able to push to vector length awareness of block size of 8. That is, we force the dynamic channel pruning techniques to chop out channels in the blocks of 2, 4, or 8. And we still see that we are able to maintain most of the baseline accuracy when compared to vanilla dynamic channel pruning technique. So we are getting the goodness of speed up, which is hardware aware, and not losing the accuracy of these networks. From a similar point of view, dynamic precision selection also breaks gem assumption. Dynamic precision selection determines certain output channels or points in certain output feature map are actually not important. And from a gem point of view, what that means is that because of this random sparsity that's introduced, your gem kernels turn into gem or dot product kernels. However, again, we are able to force a certain sense of hardware awareness into these dynamic precision selection techniques. And we see that when we do that, our dot product instructions turn into gem V instructions. And in fact, when we do that, and when you make them hardware aware, we still retain the goodness of these techniques while creating MAC reductions that would actually translate into speedups. Now, I have glossed over a lot of details as to how these techniques work, how to write efficient kernels for them, and a lot of other techniques, insights as to why they work. But for the purpose of brevity, I have skipped over them here, and I'll point you to these papers that we have published in this domain for more details. Right, so that is all I had for today. Thank you for allowing me to present this work here, and I'm open to questions now.
Thank you, Amrish. Thank you very much. I don't see a live question at this point, but perhaps I'll ask you something. I'm not sure if I missed it, but is there some dependency on the neural network model in terms of the efficiency you get from your approach? Let's say a VGG versus a mobile net or something very irregular. Have you looked at different networks?
Right, so this was still an early work. So we have looked at various versions of ResNet for different data types, and things look good there. But people have done work on mobile net also from a dynamic channel tuning point of view. Mm-hmm. So people have done that. People have not done hardware-aware dynamic channel pruning for these large networks, and that was something that we were pursuing as next steps for this particular project.
Okay, I guess you would also go beyond CIFAR-10 as a next step, because the sensitivities may be much higher in a more challenging problem, right?
Yeah. So we were scaling to CIFAR-100 and then ImageNet slowly towards that before I left this particular project.
Yeah. Now, this is the issue. It's very computationally intensive, right? Any of these experiments. So you want to.
Yeah. So always the idea is to start small, see if things work out in a smaller domain. If they don't, then yeah.
Right. <actually haven't. laughs> Okay. Thank you very much.
I'd like to acknowledge our sponsors. First, it's ARM that develops software and hardware for TinyML. Qualcomm. Samsung, these three are the executive sponsors. And then followed by Platinum sponsors, PTA Compute, Lattice Semiconductors, and the Gold sponsors are BrainChip Corporation, Cisco, DSP Group, Edge Impulse, EMSA Visual Sense, Gerald Matter Labs, Green Waves Technologies, Hymax, ImagiMob, Latent AI, Maxim Integrated, Kixo, Reality AI, SenseML, Silicon Labs, Sentient, and Google TensorFlow. Exmos and the silver sponsors are Edge Cortex, Hoyts, and Synsense. Again, we are very grateful for their continued support, and this is a great testimony that the foundation and this community is really of huge interest for the companies and for the whole world.